right, so I'm going to talk about small loop antennas, also known as magnetic loop antennas. Before we jump into that though, my background, I got my license at the start of last year. Kind of caught the bug, ended up upgrading in the summer up to extra because I wanted to use HF and try out a bunch of other things. But when it comes to HF, I had a drawback in operating where I live, which is that I live in a condo. I don't have anywhere I can put a permanent antenna. I don't even have any external property that's like on the balcony that's fine, I can't fix anything. So I started looking at different ways to do indoor antennas or balcony mounted antennas. And I also wanted to maybe get outside a little bit. So I had some experiments. I set up a 20 meter long end-fed wire inside my condo one day from like the kitchen all the way through the house to the bedroom. It worked. I contacted Venezuela on digital. But that's not a permanent solution to have a 60-foot wire running through your house. So I kept walking into it.
Are you married?
Yeah, I could have left it there. Yeah. So that wasn't a permanent solution. I kept looking around. And one of the things that I wanted to try was something that was portable I could set up outside. You know, there's the buddy pole type setups. I couldn't use that as well inside my house. So I went towards the sort of magnetic small loop setup like this, which is fairly easy to carry around. It doesn't pack up as small as a wire, but I can still put it in a backpack. I'm also involved with Fairfax County's Community Emergency Response Team CERT program. So I wanted to have something I could use in an MCOM type environment as well. And potentially even environments where I didn't have a lot of choice about where I was setting up, so I would be able to go find the right tree, find the right spot, something like that. So with that said, what makes an antenna a small loop versus a regular loop? And why is it called magnetic? So they're called magnetic because they're more sensitive to the magnetic portion of the field in the near field around the antenna. When you get far away from the antenna, they're equally sensitive as a regular antenna to the electric and magnetic portions. But up close, when you're under a quarter wavelength, it's more sensitive than a usual antenna on the magnetic side. The small portion of it comes from the size in relation to the wavelength. So the sort of approximation figure is if the diameter of the loop is less than 1/10 of the wavelength, that's when you get into small loop behaviors versus what you would see with a full size loop. Like the big full wave loops up in the trees, they have different patterns, different behaviors than a small loop. There's a range in the middle where you're between 1/10 of the wavelength and the full wavelength where you go through a number of different behaviors. But less than 1/10 is when you're getting into magnetic and small loop. Now, this particular one is a sort of advertised as a 10 meter, 20 meter, and 40 meter small loop. But it's just about 1 meter wide. So it's 10 meters, it's exactly 1/10 of the wavelength. But now you get down to 20 meters and you're 1/20, 40 meters and you're 1/40. So as you move down further away from that point of a wavelength over 10, you're starting to give up some stuff. And I'll get into more details on that a little further on. But that sort of puts a bound on how much you can cover with one antenna. So if you have something like this that's 1 meter wide, it's designed to work on 10, it'll work okay on 20, it still works on 40. You get below that and you're starting to really lose efficiency below 40. So you'll see amateurs who've built small loop antennas or commercially available small loop antennas, they're usually gonna come in a 2 or 3 band range, like a 10, 20, 40, 20, 40, 80. I've seen some people build 40 meters, 16 foot wide loops in the backyard that's still a small loop from the sense of the radio wave that is designed to capture, even though it's not physically small anymore. So to go with those sizes, there are trade-offs that you make when you're designing or putting together a loop. And it comes down to, with these sorts of antennas, you really need to pick two out of small, efficient, or broadband, the ability to capture a wide range of, or transmit on a wide range of frequencies at one time. And in this case, this is a small antenna, and we're already talking about small loops, so we've already chosen small, right? A transmitting loop, you're looking for small and as efficient as you can get to transmit. And what that ends up meaning is that you want a very high Q. So the Q factor in the terms of the antenna is the rate, or how steep the range of frequencies that are in tune are. It's not a great way to explain it, but how sharp? Yeah. So in this particular graph that you can see here, it's not very big, but you can see the red line is the SWR measurement for a loop similar to this one, a different one by the same manufacturer. And they're measuring how wide in kilohertz the 2-to-1 points are apart on that particular antenna. So this is it's in 24.9 megahertz, and the 2-to-1 SWR points are 113 kilohertz apart. So that's fairly narrow, especially if you're used to like a dipole or a full-size loop. This particular antenna is actually even narrower than that. I think the 2-to-1 points on this antenna are closer to 17 kilohertz apart, which sounds, horrible at first glance, but actually is kind of what you want with a magnetic loop, as long as it's not so narrow that you can't use it. Because in exchange for having that higher sharpness to what's in tune, you have less resistive losses in the antenna, and the ratio of your resistive loss to your radiation resistance is what's going to determine how efficient the antenna is. So as you lose less to heating up the antenna, because you have the broadband magnetic antenna, you're going to get more out. So to compare it, this is a receive-only loop, which is a bigger one. It's actually, this wire is 5 meters. So this is, 5 meters in circumference. So it's more like, it's a decent amount bigger than this one. But this is advertised as a receive-only active loop for 9 kilohertz to 200 megahertz, which is a much huger range. And the trade-off there is that the broadband on this is absolutely enormous, but it has no efficiency. And this little box isn't there to tune it. It's actually a low noise amplifier, because the signals are so small it needs to amplify it. If you tried to transmit through this, you would just probably melt it.
Fry the solid state components.
Yes. But it's actually, this one, if we look at the range on here, this is probably, around a meter and a half in diameter. So, but it goes all the way up into UHF for receive. So it actually, within its working range, there's part of it that's small magnetic loop. There's part of it that's sort of right at the edge of magnetic loop. And then it goes into full loop and then multi-wavelength loop by the time you get up to the top of its range. So this is this is a different trade-off. This is small and broadband. And then you, for comparison, you have a full wave loop where you're angling for efficiency and broadband at the exchange of size, right? Because it's the equivalent size of a 10 meter full wave is it's 10 meter wire versus this 3 meters of wire here. So component-wise, there's a couple things that make up a magnetic loop antenna. You've got your resonant loop around the outside. You've got some method of coupling it. And you've got a tuning system, usually a capacitor, that is all put together. Now, there's a bunch of different ways to do each of those. The resonant loop, this one is coax. And it's actually, this is LMR400, and it's using the shielding to do the actual transmission. The shielding and the center of the coax is connected, so it's not just a regular piece of coax, it's slightly modified. But people use all sorts of different coax. I've seen heliax used. diameter is helpful for efficiency. So people, as they're building more permanent and non-portable loop antennas, they'll move up to copper piping or various other metal tubes to go around and build it up. As you start to build antennas that are using tubing and stuff like that, though, one thing you have to watch out for is the joints, because every little bit of resistance that you put into this outer loop is going to severely impact your efficiency of the antenna.
Are you going to address the size, the radius of the conductor itself?
This part itself? Yeah, so there is a direct relationship between the diameter of the conductor and the efficiency of the antenna.
Your diagram shows a load resistor or something inside the box. Is that true?
Down on the left there?
Yeah. In series to the capacitor?
Yes, that is true. That is the resistance of this entire...
Oh, okay.
The wire and the connectors.
Oh, it's a distributed resistance.
That's the distributed resistance of the system. Yeah.
Okay.
Not necessarily a direct... It's not actually a resistor.
Okay.
Yeah. So you can also make a different shape. It doesn't have to be a circle. But the circle is going to give you the most area for a given perimeter.
With a loop, a transmitting loop, which ways does the RF go? Does it go through the loop or out to the sides?
This way. I'll go into much more detail on that in a little bit.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So that's the outer loop. The coupling, this is a coupling loop. In this case, the feed line is connected directly to this coupling loop, which is just sitting next to the resonant loop. So this is kind of acting like a transformer, basically. There's other ways of connecting your feed to your resonant loop. There's some gamma matches are used. I have some pictures of those coming up. There's also capacitive networks, which is one of the earlier systems. The Army used those. And I've also seen it done with ferrite coils as a match. But in this particular case, this one is a capacitor inside of the connector. Oh, I'm sorry, this is the coupling loop. The capacitor inside here is used to tune it. So since it has that very narrow, sharp portion that you can see, this tuning this capacitor, there's a knob on the bottom of it down here. As you tune this, that will move your resonant point for the outer loop around on the band to change where this is resonant and where you're going to pick
this. This is used for transmit?
This can also be used for transmit.
What power limit?
This particular one is 35 watts. That's a very good question. So power drives your selection of how you're doing the tuning. So this is an air-gapped capacitor.
Yes, it
does. This air-gapped capacitor is good up to about 35 watts SSB or 25 watts CW. As you move into higher power, you can go to vacuum variable capacitors. And I've seen loops that go up to 150, 250 watts. Using vacuum variable. The reason for that is high voltages. The peak voltage in this system when you're transmitting is right here at the capacitor, and it can be hundreds of volts. At higher powers, it can be thousands of volts. And if you try to run more than 35, 40, whatever the safety margin for this is, watts through this, as those voltages creep up, you'd eventually arc between the plates and the capacitor, damage it, not do it.
Probably not good to the
view. Yeah, not good for any situations, yeah. So, the other thing that this particular one has is a reduction gear in here between the knob and the capacitor. Because the tuning can be so fine as you move things around, it really helps to have that. This one's a 6-to-1 reduction that helps you fine tune as you're trying to get exactly on a certain frequency. Otherwise, it can be very easy to sort of jump back and forth across where you're trying to resonate. So here's some examples. The Alex loop on the left is another popular portable one. It's very similar in style to this. It's got a coupling loop, it's got a capacitor, it's got a foldable pole, it's got a piece of coax that you unwind. This picture on the right is this antenna right here. And that's the capacitor inside of it. Big air-gapped overlapping plates capacitor with the reduction gear at the bottom. These two antennas are both designed to be carryable, easy to pick up, even hold them while you're using the receive and so on.
What's the price tag on that?
This one is about $300. And I think the Alex Loop is in the same ballpark. But there's certainly options to build your own, too.
Your diagram, the previous one, the way you had it coupling, it looks like it's an impedance transformer. So what's the impedance of the antenna itself? It looks like you're matching it to 50 ohms.
Yeah, this is 50 ohms.
So, but I mean, what's the impedance of the antenna that you've got it? What I'm saying is the diagram looks like it's an impedance transformer. It looks
yes.
like it's an impedance coupling device. It's an impedance matching device.
Yeah, and the impedance match, when you're choosing the ratio of loop diameter here to the outer loop diameter, that and the material you're using in the outer diameter, I think both comes into play on that match. I can't speak to it in great detail.
Okay, so is it a low, I assume it's a very low impedance antenna. I assume you're dialing to 20 ohms kind of?
Oh yeah.
Very low, right?
Very low.
So you gotta match it to the
And this brings it up, yes.
To get any coupling.
Yeah. Okay. So this is a 50 ohm.
Right, at that point.
Yeah. So here's an example of, and it's a little hard to see with the light on. This one is a gamma match. So it's got a portion here that comes up and goes across. So instead of having the coupling loop, it's using a gamma match to tie the feed into the loop. And its capacitor is up at the top. Since this one's up on a mast, the approach here is there's actually a servo next to the capacitor that can move the capacitor to adjust that for tuning.
Wi-Fi?
What was that?
Remote.
I don't know Wi-Fi. What they're. I think that one is actually. Could
come right through the hollow tubing.
It could. Well, that tubing is actually the resonant loop. Yeah. So you wouldn't want to necessarily put your control system right next to it, because you could induce some pretty hefty currents in your control system. That's you'll see in one of the next ones another solution to that problem. But I'm not sure. Actually, there was no information on this one about how they were communicating with the tuning.
Or getting power up there to run the tuning.
Yeah. So that one is, this one's actually capable of 250 watts, is what they said it was capable of. So that's got a much higher voltage rated capacitor up at the top. So here's some homemade ones. That one on the left is by KK5JY, and you can see, this is a vacuum variable capacitor. So that's sitting up at the very top there. The vacuum variable capacitor, and he's got a long dowel running up the loop to get the motor that's going to turn the capacitor well away from the rest of the electrical system. And then the actual coupling loop is a little further up inside, which he has explanations on his page as to why he did that, if you want to look into it. The one on the right here is another type of capacitor. This one's a trombone capacitor that kind of moves in and out, and then the coupling loop's down here at the bottom. I think he's got a pulley system to adjust the capacitor from below. There's like a wire that runs over, or cord that runs over the top. So both of those are homemade. That one's coax, and that one I think is a piece of solid metal. So there's a lot of different ways you can make these. I've also seen, I came across this while I was doing some of the research. This was interesting to me. This is a mag loop printed on a circuit board where it's the same kind of antenna that we were just talking about with all those other designs, but here's the coupling loop on the opposite side of the circuit board, and here's a closed trace on this side of the circuit board that's your resonant loop, and there's a capacitor right here to tune that loop, in this case to 318 megahertz.
What's the physical dimension across the thing?
It's 318 megahertz. It's quite small. I want to say.
The wavelength's a meter, it's a tenth of a meter.
Yeah.
4 inches.
Yeah, something like that. Or in this case, it might actually be a little smaller. They might have given up space or gotten some shrinkage or given up efficiency. But yeah, it's a couple centimeters. Yeah.
Couple of centimeters,
yeah, probably in that range. Yeah. So there's also been some military usage of loop antennas over the years. This, the one on the left, is a modern Harris antenna. And inside that block at the bottom is a frequency counter and a capacitive matching network, where they're doing the capacitance resonance and the feed match in the same location using capacitor network. I don't have any more details than that on that one, than that was sort of in their data sheet. But it is the one modern example of a sort of capacitive match that I found. And this picture on the right is from World War II. It's a U-boat hunting US convoys in the Atlantic. That particular U-boat is now off the Outer Banks, so it was sunk. But if you see in the top right, there's a big loop. And they were using that loop to find the Allied convoys in the Atlantic as a direction finding antenna. So that leads to the question is of why is this a good direction finding antenna? And that plays back into the question you asked about the pattern of the antenna. So this antenna is kind of like a donut, right? So the radiation comes out this end, like it's going out in all directions. There's a big knoll right here through the middle. So when you look down on it from above, this is the axis of the loop, and there's these knolls that are, you know, about 15 degrees wide or so, depending on the particular antenna, that come out the center axis in either direction. So one way you can direction find with this is to turn it until the signal goes away.
That actually quite works. When I lived in San Diego, I built a 40 meter magnetic loop. I had a guy line of sight across the valley who was also operating on 40 meters doing PSK at the same time. And so I just, I nulled him out by turning the loop.
Yeah. So you can null out individual signals, you can null out noise. If you have a local noise source, it's really good for that.
But it's bidirectional.
But it's bidirectional. Yeah, so.
There's no way to fake it to suppress one of the loops.
You can. Some of the like direction finding specific loop antennas put another vertical sense antenna connected into it, which turns the pattern into like a cardioid pattern where you only have a null on one side, but it's much broader. So for those direction finding antennas, usually they'll have that sense antenna able to be taken on and off. So you can put it on, get the rough direction with the broader null, and then take it off. You have the narrow null that like zoom, focus in. Okay, so the down at the bottom left is sort of a side view of this. What does it look like, along this axis of where are the waves going? So you get simultaneously, you're going to get ground wave transmissions here. You're going to get sky wave, and you're going to get near vertical waves, and they're all going to come out in a pretty equal field off the antenna. So you don't have to your takeoff angle isn't so much of a thing with this particular antenna, because there's a sort of weak near the ground, but everything up and above all the way over is pretty much equal strength transmission and reception with this antenna. But the polarization does change. So the polarization is vertical over here. When you're looking at it as an in-vis transmission, it's more of a horizontal polarization. Which is something that I kind of like about it, because you just get a wide range of reception and transmission capabilities all at the same time. This is a picture from last weekend, the NAQB SSB contest. I had intended to go out and sit at a picnic table that's off in the back there, but it was a little wet, and I wanted to keep the radio inside the car, because it was kind of drizzling and spinning the whole time. And I really wanted to try out doing search and pounce in a contest with an antenna with a very, very sharp tuning, just to see what it was like and see what I could learn from it. So it was this same setup. It was this this Canadian antenna, which is a 10 meter to 40 meter antenna. And I was using this QRP radio here and a tablet with the software for the radio and N1MM and then a battery. So I was out there about 2 hours, I think, and mostly working 20 meters, and we worked quite well. I made a number of contacts, Texas, Wisconsin, the World Bank down in DC as a ground wave contact, and Prince Edward Island. So it was That was all kind of just turning the antenna a little bit, cancel out local noise, and tune towards different stations.
How many watts were you running?
5. And then 40 meter, I tried that a little bit, and I didn't have as much luck on 40 meters. I think the conditions were a little different, and I could hear people all right. Power and the lower efficiency of a 10 meter small loop on 40 meters, I could still do it. Had to repeat my call and my name a bit. I had one exchange where they were convinced that was in Alabama. I couldn't get them to change it, so I think that's going to go on the logs incorrectly. But that was just sort of got out of the car, popped it up, and started working. Which is something really nice with these kind of antennas. They're fast set up. You don't need to find a tree. You don't need to set up a mast. You don't need to set up radials. The ground isn't too important. You need to have this sufficient height off the ground. It's not like a quarter wave vertical where the quality of the ground is super important. But you do need to be able to reach it, especially one like this where you don't have an automated tuning system. You'll have to do it by hand. So I had it out of the car and I had it up about this high off the ground so I could step out, adjust the tuning, or just quickly rotate it as I was trying to focus on different parts of what's going on.
Using an automatic tuner, or you actually have to tune that, huh?
I was doing this.
So you're doing straight?
Just straight tuning it here.
So you're not using a tuner on the transceiver?
Correct. Yeah, I don't use a tuner like this.
And you have this little SWR right here in the rig, and the rig has it built in?
Yeah, there's an SWR meter on the rig, but I'll get into how I tune it in a second here. The other thing is magnetic near field. Like some antennas, if you get close to them, it's going to throw you're going to get a weird tune because of your interference with the antenna. This particular one, as long as you're not touching the antenna, if you're just adjusting this knob, it doesn't really have too much of an impact on the tuning. I've seen some other loops where there's not as good isolation, where you kind of capacitively couple a little bit with it when you touch it to tune it. It kind of shifts it a little bit, which can be kind of, I'm sure, a bit frustrating to try and tune a loop like that. So the question here was, this works better when it's away from large metal objects because it's a magnetic antenna. But like, this particular picture, it's directly over my car, pretty much. But it still worked okay. I only have so much feed line, and I wanted to get it up high rather than far away from the car.
So you recalibrate the knobs
for a given band? Not really. It's pretty quick to tune. I'll go into that right after this. So this is a safety chart from the FCC, just to give an idea. So this particular chart is for 150 watt loop, so it's much higher power than I was running. And it's for a controlled space, not an uncontrolled exposure. It's 2 to 2.4 meters is the distance for a safe controlled operation at 150 watts. On a small loop like this. So this loop, this one comes with just a short feed line, and that's really all you need. I sort of just take it out to the end of the feed line, and that's about where I operate it from. It's safe, and with these loops, it's sort of an efficiency tightrope, so you don't want to have tons and tons of feed line, and you don't want to be running back and forth to tune it if you don't have a remote tuner. There's another one manufactured by this company that does have a remote system. There are other ones that have remote systems. But you can pretty safely operate it at this distance, right? Even at higher powers. Sure. So, tuning. Antenna tuners can throw you off with magnetic loop. So, if you're using antenna tuner, you're trying to impedance match what's going on through your whole transmission system. With these antennas, what you're doing when you're adjusting the capacitor is you're changing the resonance point of the loop. So if you're not resonant at the frequency you want, you can tell your tuner to make the best of it, but that's just gonna give you a weird feedback of what the actual situation is. So I think the best way to approach that is to leave the antenna tuner out and tune it directly or remotely, but tune the antenna itself to the resonant point. Because an automatic tuner is going to sort of lead you a little astray. What was that?
So that's why
why SWR is misleading.
Yeah, exactly. So the general approach that I take with this is start off by listening to the noise. You're going to hear a noise peak as it goes, as you go through where it's tuned. Also, you can look at the S meter as well and sort of tune for that peak. And then you can go in and do fine adjustments by, you know, putting on a tuning mode on the radio, put on the signal, adjust it. Also, my preferred way to do it is a pan adapter. And the reason for that is a little hard to see with this light, but this is about 160 kilohertz wide pan adapter. And you can see out here the background noise is black, kind of goes up and peaks blue here and goes back black. So you can kind of, you can get your resonant point and a good fall off on screen at the same time with the pan adapter. And you can very quickly visually tune it. And as an example of that, I'll show you what that looks like. This is a shortwave broadcast. So that particular broadcast, I turned this on just to make a recording for demonstration purposes, and the first thing I came across was that, which is from Romania. That's Radio Romania broadcasting the French broadcast. And it was indoors. So the other thing that comes up in, this was something I did during the contest, was I'm trying to make use of the null points on the antenna to help out. The nulls are very, very narrow, so you can use that to either cancel out a nearby source of noise, which is what's happening here. There's the noise is blue here, there's a black band here in the middle, and it goes blue again. There was a transformer or something down the street from where I was that was putting out some noise, and just by rotating the antenna a little bit, I could get that noise source into the null point on one side of the antenna without really impacting the other signals. The other thing I tried to use the nulls for in this particular case is right here, there are three overlapping SSB signals that are 1 kilohertz apart. So 1 kilohertz, another kilohertz up, another kilohertz up. And I was trying to separate them out and, you know, point the null at one of them or two of them so I could hear the other one, contact the other one. In this case, I think they were all in the Midwest, so they were all in that same little cone. I couldn't separate them apart. But that technique does work better when you've got, you know, a station this way and a station this way, and they're kind of stepping on each other. You kind of pick
probably,
one.
Those are probably SkyWave, and you can't call SkyWave.
That's okay. That's a good point. Yeah, so SkyWave, or I'm sorry, knowing like this works much better with ground.
That's a common fault de-effing of groups called light effect. When you get ionospheric propagation, you get confused. Mary Earhart found that out when she couldn't figure out which way was which on their loop and crashed.
Okay, so the cause of it not working is?
SkyWave.
The
null is on the horizon.
Oh, yeah, yeah, so it's coming in.
And you're coming down from the top.
Yeah, so your null is a cone.
Yeah, it's actually directly through the axis of the
wave. Yeah, right, exactly.
Can you tilt the thing back?
You can tilt these all the way.
That was something that happens to the ground reflection when you do that.
Yeah, so that's something I didn't mention earlier. You can tilt this horizontally.
Mm-hmm.
But you're going to have to send it much higher. At that point, it, you know, your nulls are straight up and down if you tilt it horizontally, and you need to get it high off the ground to be effective.
There is one point of you want to tilt it over to get another mull toward the sky. You have a ground reflection that's worth getting right into the loop, so that sort of eats your lunch.
Yeah.
I've tried it. So have many other people.
So thank you.
You guys are making me think.
Well, we don't want to do that.
Some other observations were that when you have a contest situation, it would be very, very painful to individually tune every single station that you want to try and contact. But with this particular antenna, you know, I've got a 2-to-1 SWR range, depending on the band, of 20 kilohertz, 30 kilohertz, 40 kilohertz. You can fit a lot of 3 kilohertz wide signals in that band. So if there's a cluster of stations that you want to work, you can kind of tune to the middle of them and work all those, and then tune somewhere else. Instead of trying to get everyone exactly on the nose, you're giving up a little bit of SW, you know, a little bit of efficiency on the ones that aren't in the middle, but it was good enough to work them. And the other aspect of it is you don't need to tune it to receive necessarily. You can still receive a decently strong signal when it's fairly far off of your tuned resonant point. So if you look at the, this, like my resonant point is right here in the middle of the screen, but you can still see signals over on the left and signals over on the right that are readable, and I can tune over to those and listen to them, decide if I wanted to work them, and then actually adjust the antenna when I decide I wanted to work them.
Is there a name for that, like the RT factor?
I don't know. The other area where this is what originally got me into this antenna was digital modes. So things like JT65, PSK, a lot of those use watering hole frequencies, where having to be, you know, the fact that you have to tune it to a particular spot, each thing you're gonna work doesn't really matter. You know, you tune it to that watering hole and you're good to work all the different things you're doing.
Yeah,
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's been my experiences so far with these magnetic antennas. So these are some resources I came across while I was doing research. The top one I found, N4SPP's site, had a lot of really good information about design alternatives and the electrical behavior behind these. So I recommend, if you want to learn more about that, that is a great place to start. These next two had good information about efficiency and some more construction notes. And if you want to really get into the theory, the antenna theory book had a lot of detail about that side. Any questions?
Well, I have one thought, mentioning the breakdown of capacitors when
yes.
you go up in power. Reminds me that I have a Tektronix oscilloscope probe, 1,000-to-1, good to 40 kV, which has to have a little bit of a special freon squirted into it and then sealed.
Yeah.
That could boost your voltage threshold a bit at least, although probably not much given the spacing of the capacitor.
Yeah, there are some that have oil dipped capacitors, like a capacitor in like a mineral oil of some sort to handle higher voltage. Yeah.
Have you had success using it indoors?
A little bit. I haven't had a lot of success with SSB indoors so far. I have been doing digital stuff.